life and transformed it into an urban resort of calm with the sound of running water and greenery pervading throughout the hotel, with Colin Otachimo, the landscape architect. Massive Jade was the first project in the new practice. It's a four-story apartment on a 5,700 square meter site. The building form and the architectonics was in response to the height restrictions and issues of visual privacy between the units and the communal space. The distinctive copper cladded barrel-shaped roof concealed the attic space to achieve the optimal GFA. The extensive, operable and adjustable timber louvers provided sun shading and privacy to the balcony ledges. I believe Massim J was the prototype of this genre. Maybank Singapore. This was a two-stage competition. The site area is only 1,000 square meters on the banks of Singapore River. Against conventional wisdom, we actually had the banking hall below ground, lit by a glazed plaza to free the ground floor for more foreground space to the Fullerton building. Because of the soft marine clay, the four levels of park are elevated above the plaza, topped up by a swimming pool and deck with views of the harbor. The offices are elevated above this and are double volume with a mezzanine for executive offices, all with uninterrupted views of the harbor. All the floors are suspended by tension cables from cantilevered roof trusses supported by the service pole. The House of Bishopsgate. It is in an old company subdivided estate with many mature bamboo trees of 30 to 40 meters high, which are to be conserved. Our site is dominated by one which requires a 7 meter radius clearance, constraining the siting of the house. The client had initially opined that a well-known American architect was recommended to her, but after meeting him in New York, Singapore was too distant, and he was in his 70s, although I wasn't not much younger. However, she bought me his monographs, which featured barn-like houses with lofty ceilings. We took this imagery and impishly proposed it to be done in fair-faced concrete, including the roof, which to our delight was accepted. There was another unusual request to provide a dual entrance, as the son-in-law would otherwise not live in the house, even though his accommodation is separated on the lower ground floor. We solved this conundrum by providing two main entrance doors between the staircase, so that the son-in-law would use the descending flight and the parents the ascending flight. Two front doors and the staircase behind us. House at Cable Road. On the site, there is an existing black and white bungalow built in the 1920s and was used as a mess for expatriate bachelors, which is to be conserved. Unlike its peers, there was no back of the house accommodation, so we proposed to build a new extension in its place. But we did not want to replicate the architecture of the existing house, as it would have been mimicry. Instead, we echoed the masonry base and timber frame upper story of the historic house, with the new addition done in reinforced concrete and steel frame, and carefully studied the scale of the new and old, resulting in a harmonious composition. We inverted the traditional porte-cochere entrance to enter from the new wing and convert it into a patio for the living room. Montema is a true example of the eponymous cluster house typology. Each cluster comprised of four units planned in a radial pattern, offering a corner situation with two aspects compared to a typical terrace or semi-detached development. The entire three-story unit with a common basement is in board marked fairface in situ concrete like Thai Phan Thanh, except that the cross walls are stained charcoal gray, defining each unit in the cluster. All the units have access to the roof to enjoy 360-degree views of Bukit Timah Reserve and the environment. Tokyo Marine Center is an office building and headquarters in Asia, occupying a corner site of 1,300 square meters. After Christmas language dredging, there was an opportunity to show an alternative approach from the ubiquitous and anonymous curtain wall solution proliferated throughout the corporate world. We return to the basic design of high-rise. We return to the basic design of high-rise building, which is stiffness against wind loads. We found inspiration in the organic growth patterns of bamboo. Although slender, they gain strength by leaning against each other. Using this analogy, the periphery of the car is an exoskeleton of columns, facing each other, tilting upwards on three sides, creating large space for the higher floors. The car is segmented into three zones. The lowest is a triple volume entrance plaza, with a fully automated car park above, followed by offices and crowned by a sky terrace for the use of office tenants and events. It's the ground floor, three-story ground floor, open to the public. The column-free space of a typical office floor. And this is the sky terrace where we will be taking food. And the reflecting pool, the water level can also be drained down so that the whole additional floor space can be used for events. If sun shading provided by the glazing setback, the stained fairface exoskeleton, and aluminum-cladded lateral floor edge beam, Tokyo Marine stands out amongst corporate peers. National Art Gallery. The NAG was an international competition. There were 111 entries from 29 countries. CSY collaborated with Lecker Design. Our proposal avoided basement excavation below the two conserved monuments because of the marine clay and high water table and differing foundations. Supreme Court is still piled and City Hall on patchwork base. A new entrance portal is inserted between the two buildings through which visitors can enter either building via interconnecting bridges. A voice on the podium level of the city hall is stepped over to form a classic piano nobile. Similarly, the voice on the top of the city hall are partially left over to create new gallery space with external views of Marina Bay. Our design was chosen by the international jury panel as the top three finalists. However, we did not win. Josh, would you like to add? So I come to the end of my talk. Thank you.
Hello everyone, can you hear me? You can. The beauty of following Sunny in a forum like this is that he's short half the project I wanted to show. So he's actually done half of my work. That's like great collaboration. Thank you. Just a very brief introduction on Sunny and I. I met Sunny. Sunny was the first person in Singapore I spoke to. On the first day of my first flight trip to Singapore, I went to the hotel, dropped my bags, went to a restaurant, and had dinner with him. And that was like over 25 years ago. And last time we had coffee together was last night. So we haven't continued collaborating and working, going through a lot of pain, a lot of joy, and a lot of other things. You shared a lot of things, some of which I can tell you about, like I've told you. Others maybe I don't want to case, I think that's a bit embarrassed. Like we shared the room once, right? In Bali. I use my time going through the project. Now I've prepared a presentation in four small parts. The first part is flicking through some of the projects that my company and myself have worked quite a lot of it with Sunny and with other good architects like Maria and Wow and other good people. We've worked in the past 25 years on over 600 projects in about 28 different countries, substantially from India to China, but also projects in Africa, Europe, and the US, etc. Some of the projects I just flicked through so that you get a flavor of the sort of thing that we've done. I won't go through the details of the projects. MediaCorp with Marquis Office and BPA here. Recently finished. Tokyo Marine, one of my favorites, that Sunny also talked to you about. Capella with Foster Partners in Sentosa. Asia renovation of NBC with another very close friend of mine, Chan Suk Kian and SEDA. Going back a few years with Forum Architect Tan Kai Kiang, the multiple award-winning mosque of Ashafar. We've been doing some houses, a Sunny Shore as well. This is a sort of house without the grid with Kempeng and the Minda. Another interesting house which we've recently finished with Amir. Going back about 15 years ago, Lincoln Modern with SCDA, so I think both of our offices' first tall building at that time, about 30 stories. I don't know whether you can see this thing, but the width of this, the effective width of the structure, if you take the height of the building divided by the effective width, it's about 30. It's a very, very slender tower. Petronas Towers is sort of 8. So that's a sort of comparison. Troika in KL, I'm going to KL now. Troika with Foster and Partners, you know, three towers with these sort of highly expressed structures, the Shear Walls. Grand Hyatt with Wimberley took their Seattle office. This is the palace, believe it or not. This palace we built with Ken Yang, one of the sultans in Malaysia recently. Another sort of interesting complex project with Foster's finished recently in KL. One of the 100-story buildings, these days everybody has got a 100-story building in KL. Project in Kolkata, so 240-story towers. I can't see the pointer, but it'll separate a sort of about 100 meters gap. You've got that beautiful bridge, three-story bridge spanning across. The project with Om Shumana Maria in India, north of India. The interesting thing about this, one of the interesting structures about this is that this is the tallest building in north of India. It's high seismicity, significant work. A multi-generation house in Delhi with SCDA. This is, I think, including the land, is probably reported to be the most expensive house in the world. Going back 20 years, the Four Seasons resort in Bali with John Heer, who was the guy who sort of came to Sunny High together. A more recent Four Seasons in the Seychelles. One of my favorite resorts in the Dominican Republic, an Aman resort with Heer and Cole. And another project, a resort in China with John. This was the most scary, or was that scariest swimming pool in the world with Sunny in China. And a couple of projects that we're currently doing. This is a beautiful house on top of a hill in Taipei for a diamond trader, and the house is in to have that sort of ideas of cut and beauty. Taipei, still a couple of residential buildings we're doing with Richard Rogers' office, RSHP, out of London, and you guys are aware of the beauty of collaborating and articulation of the structure and how that sort of fits into architecture. And this is a second one, which is on the drawing board at the moment. Park 7 with Sunny in KL. On Tima that Sunny mentioned, a sort of gated community in KL with Sunny's office, and the Copper House, one of my favorites, in Sentosa. Singapore Embassy in Bangkok, and on your board, with all these things, but the collaborative work that we have done has been with a bunch of people going through a range of consultants, a range of projects in different countries. Each line represents a group. The green lines are the architects with whom you collaborate, the yellow lines are consultants with whom you work, etc. It's been a fantastic journey. I've been very lucky to be able to work with good, like-minded people like Sunny, Maria, and others who are here and elsewhere. But the common thread amongst all of these has been a desire to do something interesting, to collaborate, and to add value and get that sort of common 1+1 being more than 2 and 3, and etc. Now, the second part of my talk, quickly, I talk about what I've come up with, a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but sort of hierarchy of design. Everybody seems to have a hierarchy of something for himself, so I thought I may as well have a hierarchy of design as I see it. And I borrowed it from Maslow. Maslow's hierarchy of needs, for those of you who know, it starts with physiological needs, testing food and stuff, and then security needs. And the idea is that once these needs are sort of substantially, significantly met, you have other higher level needs, like you need to belong, you need to have intimacy, And once that is sort of satisfied, you want to have prestige and feeling of accomplishment, etc. And at the highest level is self-actualization. You want to really go into creativity and other stuff. The bottom three levels you have need to receive, the top two in a way is need to give. Spiritual people have similar things as well. They see the world as five levels of physical, mental, emotional, spiritual, and divine. And they're saying that depending on which level you stand at, you look at the same thing, but you'll probably see something a little bit different. I've got five levels of engineers. At the lowest level, engineers are calculators. They just calculate. And architects come with the drawings, it's got the structure in here, the columns as well. So what's the size? They say 300 by 300, it's usually too big. Can I do 200? No, 200. 250 is my last offer. Okay, agree. It's a process of negotiation. It's not collaboration. You're not on the same side. You're on two different sides and sort of trying to do that. That is sort of, you have to comply with code standards, etc. At the next level, the engineer's role is a pattern finder. Where the architect comes up with something, in this case he hasn't actually put columns and walls, but there's a pattern in this where you can insert the structure without affecting the spaces, and then give it back to him, and off he goes. There is, again, no collaboration. You don't even have to talk to each other at this level. At the next level, there's a bit of design. The engineer is a designer, a bit of creativity, a bit of inventiveness, where you have to talk to each other, collaborate a little bit. Say, what about if I put a column in here? What if it's round? And say, okay, I can change my form and things like that. So there's a bit of an iteration. Collaboration for me starts at a higher level, where there's a level of interdependence, where you can't do your architecture until there's a meaningful structural input. At this level, architects usually come with some ideas in their head, maybe some sketches, and say, what do you think? How should we be doing this, etc. So you talk. And the highest level, obviously, is a dream collaborator, where you have to do all of these things. You have to, at the end of the day, comply with all the codes and standards, etc. But at that level, there may not even be a sketch. The architect comes with an idea, says, you know what, actually, I don't know what I want to do. But there's this office building that I want it to look like, but Sunny came with the Tokyo Marine. So I want this to be a jewel in the forest. I was like, this is the thing that's so something beautiful, pristine glass, aluminium, etc. But sitting around something which is forest-like. At the too higher level collaboration, there is a level of confidence that is required. A level of competence where you expose your ignorance. You come to the table by not knowing more than you know, because you want to learn and you want to do things. So, and that is the five levels of collaboration that I have as an engineer. So you either go into here, calculator, pattern finder, a designer, a collaborator, and a dream collaborator. The same thing applies with architects. I think at the lowest level, you come as an architect, a plan is given to you, this is a site, this is a setback, etc., not more than five stories. And you must have 45 degrees, whatever, you draw that, and that diagram becomes your design, and your work is finished. At the highest level, the planning authorities come to you, say, Mr. Rogers, we are in Beijing, we don't know what to do in this area, what do you think we should do? So the whole dynamics and relationships are different. And how do you become a dream collaborator? What is the collaboration process? In my opinion, the first step is should face each other, like that, talk to each other. Okay, I mean, it's just, you go back to each other, you can't collaborate. And, ideally, listen, rather than talk. Now, we all have the habit of starting by talking, wanting to do things, wanting to say things. But I think listening, in my opinion, is the first step for collaboration, and most of us don't do that. I don't even listen enough to try and understand what it is that we're supposed to be doing, what is this journey that we're supposed to be going together, where are we supposed to be going, and how can we do that? At the next level, once you've listened, you need to question, ask more questions, try and get to the bottom of things, try and understand more about what we're supposed to be doing, asking the how about question, how about this, how about that, what do you think? And then you design, you do something, whatever it is that maybe you're supposed to be doing, whether it's structure or architecture or interior design, whatever it is that you're supposed to be doing, you put your ideas to paper or on the screen. Once you've done that, then you have to question yourself. And after that, you then take it through a complex series of parametric studies, benchmarking, a search of complex numerical analysis, studies, whatever it is, to refine and get the best design out of the situation. So that is, I think, is the sort of five steps, in my opinion, to good collaborative work. The process is universal. I think if you go through these steps, we apply it to alteration to existing buildings, to tiny sort of small houses, to very complex tall buildings. I think if you start by listening and then go through that process, you stand a chance of collaborating and doing something interesting. But having said that, my last section of the thing is that as much as I've enjoyed the collaboration with Sunny and a lot of other collaborating guys, I have to tell you, Sunny, now that I've like moved on. I'm now collaborating with others. And not all of them are human. And I think that the ultimate collaboration for us would be between humans and machines. Things that we have that we can bring to the table, and there are very powerful machines and programs that can work with us. The design process, where it starts from a project inception, goes through concept design, code-based design, calculations, and drawing production, has a new loop in it where just go through an iteration with computational design and use very powerful machines and programs that can actually sort of talk back and tell you maybe you should be doing something else in this case at this juncture. These new collaborators are not even human beings. There are people like rhino, they're all animals. Grasshopper, obviously, caramba, Galapagos, octopus, quite a lot of these things Sam has taught me, so you can blame him. And what we do with these things is that it's a process that we go through and use the power that exists in the machine, that sort of how that empowers us to do things. This one, for instance, is a 100 meters tower that we wanted to do in timber. The CLT will be the tallest tower in CLT in the world. We've got four levels of platform, viewing platforms of certain dimensions and going in certain directions. We set the parameters as to how long we want the platforms to be, but how short we don't want it to be, how wide we want it to be, how narrow we don't want it to be, if you see what I mean. We set the parameters, and then we work with our friend here and say, can you tell me what possibilities exist? What can we do? And set the parameters, make sure the deflections are not excessive, make sure the stresses are not excessive, and then it goes through and we set the parameters that we want to optimize, and it goes through and it gives us thousands of different ways of doing the same thing, achieving that goal. Sunny showed you the Tokyo Marine thing that we're like, I don't know if you picked it up or not, but it's like we did like 19 options of Tokyo Marine, we're all exhausted. But this guy, we can do like 10,000. And then we can add more parameters, the good genes that we want to do based on the genetic algorithm that again Sam has told me. We could put the good genes that we want to go in there and then it sort of add to the requirements, and it from 10,000 it goes to 800. And if we give more, it goes down to 50. And eventually we decide what we want to do. The least carbon footprint one, the fastest one to build, etc. The next one, which is my last slide, is this one. This is a 100 meters long pavilion in one of the resorts in the Maldives. We're working on it with Ken Kuma's office. And the idea is that we want across this 100 meter span from here to here only have two internal columns. And there are certain areas that we have banned for columns to exist. Other areas, we've told my friend here, you can do put columns in these areas and tell me where you can do the things. I've given him the origami floor sort of plate arrangement. I've said that you can go up half a meter, come down half a meter. Within that zone, you can move and change the shape. But give me the most efficient two locations where I can put columns in there and make this thing stand up without it being the structure being intrusive to or obstructing the views, etc. And he's doing it for me. Again, it's gone through that box, a series of all the sort of parameters, all the things that I've told him to work with. It is working with that. And to me, if we can work together as people and then work with these highly sophisticated programs, that would be the ultimate collaboration that we all do. We have to do. It's not the future, it's now. This is happening. A lot of people are doing it, and even I am doing it. So you should all be doing it. Pretty good at it. At the end of it, it tells me, you know what I've done? The yellow area, the orange areas are the surfaces that you gave me. I haven't touched, changed them. The other areas, I've used the latitude that you've given me and changed. So I know exactly what has been changed. I can now have a look at it. If I don't like it, I can change that. And the ultimate collaboration. That's the last thing. Thank you. You see here?
So thanks to both of you, Sunny and Dr. Hossein, for sharing these slides and these projects with us. Was the Maybank headquarters the first kind of breakthrough project of the collaboration in terms of working together to look for certain kinds of typologies that that later became kind of influential for the projects that came along? Sort of, for example, like Tokyo Marine, or were there other collaborations before that where suddenly you would work together and you realized that your collaboration worked well?
The Maybank came after the Fort Canning. And what we tried to do with Fort Canning was that it's a transmission tower. And we didn't want the noodle and the stick. That most observation towers, transmission towers are like. So we wanted this similar feeling that when you go up, like in the Eiffel Tower, you're actually rising within a structure. So I think John here came up with this double helix, came down, and Dr. Hossein was actually egging on to see how that, how the design is developed from that.
So, but were you the engineer on that project, or just kind of the devil on Sunny's shoulder, telling him to?
Structurally driven, the double helix, one was going in one direction, going up, and the other one was going in the other direction, two interlocking springs going into one another. So structurally inherently stable. that once you've got two squares going in different directions and locking into one another, as us engineers say, you can't go anywhere, it just stays there. Maybank was sort of a development of that, in that it was an end of block, end of city block site, where it had three aspects. The fourth one was a party mode. So all the cores and everything, including all the structure, was sort of pushed to that site, so that the three sites could be open. And we had a very tight site, and so we actually built a crane. The structure is the structure of a crane, but the towers go at the back. Right at the top, there's a big boom that goes cantilevers towards Fullerton Hotel. And at the back, we've got a tension lodge with all the L anchors in back, so that the whole of that plaza at the front comes publicly. A similar system that we then developed and used and built, made by the fortune because it didn't get the chance to build, but built on Tokyo Marine.
Do you think at Maybank anyone doubted whether the system worked? I still see it. It looks almost impossible. That is, that I have a hard time seeing.
Yeah, you never know now. No, it is very possible. It is, you know, it is about numbers. It is about it had a solid core. The whole length of that site is core. So a lot of concrete, a lot of structure that can do the job. It's just that I think it was a lost opportunity. Instead of that beautiful building that can go, could go there, we got this monolith of a bookend. I hope none of you guys worked on that project. So I'm not going to be kind to that. It's like a bookend sitting at the end of Old Key and the last building of that nature there. But no, it would be possible. You have to trust me.
No, I believe you. Yeah, one thing that you mentioned I thought was very interesting was about the issue.